Welcome.
So today we're going to have a look at The Empire Strikes Back 1M2B, the Imperial Probe Droid, Part 2. So let's take us through. The good thing about this is that we've got Princess Leia's theme and the Han and Leia theme as well. So we've got lots to get through. I'll try and go slowly as much as I can, because it's complicated. So I'll just stop it there, and let's recap over all of that, because there's a lot going on. So first of all, just to describe the melody, I mean, lots of people have talked about this before, so I don't really need to reiterate what other people have done. The purpose of these is to try and give a slightly different insight as to what's going on. So we have a upward major sixths. Just goes up one chromatic note. Up to a minor seventh from A, and then recessions away. When I say recessions away, it dies away. So it has this sort of lovely arc shape to it all, which I think is wonderful. And then that major six becomes an octave, and then it goes up again with the same rhythm, and then it stops. It's interrupted really by Han, who comes to chat to Leia to explain why he's leaving to pay off Jabba the Hutt. So it's a lot more complicated than what it appears to be, mainly because of the way it's orchestrated. But also there's a lot going on. So just I guess the first thing to mention is, you know, we've got tune, we've got an accompaniment, and we've got a bass layer as well. And the bass layer, in this case, is static. And it generally tends to be that, you know, the passive version of the theme. I've just used that term. I don't think anybody else necessarily has. It's just a term I use for it. Is with a static bass. So passive just means static bass. And then it's developed later in the film when it's not just a static bass. So it just means that the root note just stays the same, even though the chord changes. And we've got lots of these sort of oscillations which go backwards and forwards. And I think that's really the best way to describe the way the accompaniment works. So we've got our D major 7 chord. And the clue to this is in the harp part, which is here. I haven't even bothered labelling it because it's sort of obvious, really. We've got D, F sharp, A, and C sharp. So we've got that. So it's interesting that the way it's orchestrated, Williams doesn't put the C sharp in the strings. So the extension is just put in the harp. I think maybe just because it's used as colouring rather than as a sort of functional chord. So, you know, the function of the chord is simply tonic. Which is what we've got in the strings here. So it down at the bottom, I've got one with a major 7. It's also set 420 and 419B. They're all part of the hexatonic set, which is something that, you know, comes back again and again with Williams. That's something to bear in mind. But even the harp part, even the second bar... It does that lovely little sort of upward appoggiatura, that B flat going down to A. So we could either just simply call it that. It's just that. It's just going up one note and back one down. If you want to be sort of really accurate, I guess. Then we've actually got that sort of augmented D chord. So D, F sharp and B flat. With the C sharp from before. So that the B flat sort of resolves to A, which it does. And this time he does put that sort of movement in the strings as well, which is to coincide with the horns. So he's really drawing attention to it. Then the chord changes in the upper part. Sorry, almost got it. I played a diminished seventh, and actually what I meant was a half diminished seventh, so diminished fifth, but minor seventh. Major seventh would be that. So what I found really interesting here is that the A adds another sort of dimension to it. That little A, and again it's put in the harp, nowhere else at this stage. So we've got an E half diminished, add 11 as well. You could say 4 as well. I think it's easier to say 11. Otherwise you've got that. Although that does occur, so I don't know. I mean, either way, it doesn't really make a huge amount of difference. What's interesting, though, is that it provides a sort of Locrian... which starts, if you were going do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, it starts on ti. Ti, re. Sorry, ti, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. So it's sort of F major, but the mode 6 of that. I think, is it? Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, Mixolydian, Aeolian, Locrian. 7th, mode 7. We've got all of this sort of lovely thing going on. And, of course, the horn is just sort of imitating what's happening on the melody as well. So it's very expressive, lots and lots going on at this point as well. Let's move on. So we've got half diminished chords. So it's a borrowed chord, I suppose you could argue, from D minor. I think I pointed out in a previous video that often Williams uses chords from the parallel minor key to inflect a major theme, and this is an example of it. So you could write out a scale of D major and a scale of D minor. And also perhaps have the sort of flattened seventh degree of as well, that also works, and he uses all of those chords. So we'll see C minor a little bit later on. That sort of bit later on. So let's continue with this. So oscillations between D and our half diminished on E. That's our little 11. And worth bearing in mind that it happens again. That A intrusively in our E half diminished chord. So it's again a sort of Locrian type. I suppose, I mean, I'm not a jazz specialist at all, but I suppose you could probably use that Locrian over chord two, that sort of half diminished chord. Yeah, it seems to make sense. And then it continues as well. So we keep going with this sort of add A onto this thing. Note the bass still hasn't changed. And then we've got this sort of really weird little bit of unison strings at this point. In the original sketch, which was sort of widely available, the John Williams sketch, he actually has, I think, a D, E, and an A. I think it is. Yes, D, E, and A. Which makes sense because the trombone part is playing an E natural. And then, you know, adding the D is just the seventh from an E diminished. So it's really weird that it got changed. To an E flat, which doesn't really work with that E natural. Because we get that horrible sort of minor ninth idea, which is usually to be avoided. And then it immediately changes back to E natural anyway, where we've got clarinets and the electric piano going on as well. So it's a slightly confusing one. I've just called that E half diminished over A, but it's still actually the add 11. The A is still part of that chord. And actually it's the pizzicato double bass at that point as well. So again, there are lots of different ways of looking at this, and then I've called it something else, even though it's really the same chord. In this case, it's acting, I guess, as a supertonic. But instead of going to five, it just simply goes back to D. So it's a nice sort of dominant substitution without being the dominant of the dominant quite. And the A acts as a sort of dominant. It's really weird how that works, but it's extremely clever. So, and also the add 11, I'm saying, because there's no ninth. And that would sort of make it almost like a sort of William Walton type sort of idea, which it isn't in this case. So it then immediately segues into Han and Leia's theme, or Han and Leia's theme, sorry. So we got our D add 2. Which is from, E.T. it's used. So it's a nice little flavouring of a simple major tonic chord. He uses that all the time. So it's these little added bits that make it more Williams-esque, isn't it? It's the sort of add 11, add the 2 to something, add a 6 to something, add a sharp 4. And they're often used as sort of oscillations which then resolve downwards. Occasionally they resolve upwards as well. So now we've got our Han and Leia's theme in D. So it starts in the third degree of the scale. So it's all about the oscillation between 1 and 2. In this case, it's flat 2. And it's interesting how he harmonizes the E natural at this point. So that the E natural becomes a sort of sharp four over this sort of flat six. So it's a sort of the Schubert maneuver, we call it, really. It's the submediant, flattened submediant maneuver, which is one to flat six. Which happens quite often in his symphonic work. So it's a well-established modulation. In this case, it's not a modulation, it's just a chord change. So we've got D add to. So what's going on here? There's actually quite a lot going on here because we've got the F as well. So although you can't see it quite in the harp, we've got that B-flat manoeuvre there. We've also got an E natural and a G. So actually the full chord is actually a lot more complicated. Like that. So B-flat, six, add a sharp four over D. And now we've got our Neapolitan, that just means flat two, major chord. And all of these sort of suspended notes here. So it's really interesting, that chord, isn't it? That first one. Yeah, really, really nice. So we've got now E flat over D. We could also call it E flat major seven as well. And we've got that sus four. It's quite difficult to hear on the recording, but we've got that A. You can just about hear it. Let's see. Let's listen out for this line. It's really interesting when you play at the piano, that F and E really, really clashes. But it's all about this sort of appoggiatura, isn't it? The sort of leaning note idea. So yeah, in the bassoons at that point. Yeah, and we got that C sharp acting as an upwardly resolving appoggiatura. Like that. So I've described it E flat 7. So we got all the constituent notes of E flat 7. And the A natural. That's what I call the sharp 11. Over D. So I've called it, really, it's more of a sort of, I guess you could call it sus4, but it's not really, because it's not necessarily prepared in the same part in the previous chord. So it's more of an appoggiatura, that A, and then it resolves down to the G. So then we go back into D add 2, and we can see the E in the harp part, so it's not present at this point in anything else. And the theme goes on. And now it really shifts. The bass to E flat with our sharp four. So that's as 4Z29, major chord with a fourth. Sharp four. So just whatever the semitone below that is, the fifth note of the scale. And then it has this lovely maneuver down to the C. So C minor with an added 13th. So with our A. And then back to D as well. So really, really lovely at that point. And also if we sort of, you know, just that little bit of that sort of sharp 11, F sharp at this point with the C. So if we think of 11 as four, it's really clever. And then the fifth is omitted, which happens quite often in Williams, I've noticed. I might do some more of that. I need to do a bit more study on it myself, I think. So let's continue. We can hear that E clearly. Yep, just a little nice little thing here. It's sometimes awkward, I guess, if you're in a door to program that sort of cello part. It can sound very clunky, but notice that, you know, the third is got rid of, is put an octave higher. Anyway, let's move on. Droids. Just before we get into it, so just two bar linking into this. So we've really got a wrong bass. Very much nothing to do with D at all. What's interesting, though, is that when we get into the droid theme, we've got our 420 again, which is a D with a major seventh, but in this case, the major seventh is in the bass. In other words, the lowest note. I'm going to put my octave pedal on. So with that, with the B flat, we get set 521. If I add an F natural to it, it really is a full hexatonic scale, 620. So it is worth bearing in mind, I prepared this for my patrons. So I've done sort of various things where I actually start off with, you know, sometimes the prime form of something as it's listed in the pitch class set theory list on Wikipedia. So this one. So if we go to 620, you'll see it. So here, O to Napoleon. So 014589. So I'll do that first. 014589. Zero being C, one being D flat, two being D natural, etc. And then I sort of, you know, do the next mode up. So starting on the D flat, and then, you know, mode two, if you transpose them back to the starting pitch, you get sort of different spreads of these sorts of things. So in terms of the triads that you can get out of it, interestingly enough, with the hexatonic set, you can get these minor chords. You can also get major chords. So I'm referring to this transposed version here. So C, E flat, and G. We can also get the major version and the augmented version. So there's a lot of variety. Then only one augmented chord on the E flat. Then only one on the G. like that as well, A flat and A flat, augmented. And then this is something which I basically just completely copied from Richard Cohn's Maximally Smooth Cycles, Hexatonic Systems and the Analysis of Late Romantic Triadic Progressions in Music Analysis, Volume 15, Number 1, 1996. It's possible to check it all, and he calls them sort of north, east, south and west as well, with all of these interchangeable degrees, scale degrees, which are inherent in the original ones. So here we've got C, we've got E flat, we've got E natural, that's there as well. G is there, A flat is there, B natural, etc. And they all sort of, modulate into the next one. So we've got four possible transpositions of these things. In other words, just being transposed by one semitone, hence T, which is transposition. Zero is just untransposed, one is one semitone, two is two semitones, three is three semitones. So then I talk about these sort of sets that he tends to use. And it's interesting, isn't it? Because, it's not just random. So, 520, he's introducing that 521, in fact, it's 521B, I think, in this case, first. And then all of the possible four note sets. 420 we've seen different versions of the sort of the major seventh chord or a minor chord with a flat six. In this case, it's major chord. In that case, definitely recognisable. And then also this 14B chord. So major chord with a flat six is usually the version that we have. And then a bunch of sort of three note sets, which then seem to correlate to and be able to modulate to octatonic systems as well, because of the fact that they're used in both hexatonic and octatonic, and also Hungarian minor, and also harmonic minor as well, and harmonic major. So there's loads and loads of things going on here. So it's not always just random. So I always think that you knowing those pitch classes is really interesting, because it gives you access to a melody you might not have written before. And now it's just transposed upwards here. So we've got D, I guess either upwards or downwards. 420 again. And then we've got B flat, major seven as well, as a sort of chord progression. So it's really interesting. And then still got this sort of wrong bass. Quirky. That's sort of that cue. I think it's just really, really lovely. We'll listen to the droid. And it sort of stops there. So one of the things to bear in mind, we've got pizzicato violins at this point against the repeated horns, which is another sort of technique that happens quite frequently in John Williams as well. So there's lots going on. I hope you've enjoyed that. It's really interesting just sort of really going to a huge depth with it, because there's always things that you tend to miss from the recorded version. Things like this added 11th. It's really interesting in terms of added notes. What have we got? Let's not include the seventh. So that's not quite added. That is, because we've got one there. Then moving on to the next page. We've got another one here, another one there, another one here and there, actually five, another one there, six, two added notes at that point, another one there. And going on, another one there, another one, another one, another one, another one, another one. Virtually every chord, which has some sort of, let's call it tension device, literally tension, extension, has an added note within it. And that's also what gives it this sort of coloration. You've got to be very careful where it gets put. So... in terms of where they are, the added notes are in the harp, but not anywhere else. Everything else is just a regular chord. And that's worth bearing in mind. It changes somewhat where he adds this in the horn. So he is actually sort of, doing that. Here, if you think about it, G, A and B flat, all the extensions are in there. And also in the inner part. And also, let's forget that anomaly. So it's really a sort of very much a sort of Locrian sort of mode as well. But we don't really think of it in a Locrian. He's not writing it, oh, let's write an E Locrian mode. It's just the natural byproduct of having an E half diminished. Of having that sort of chord, of this half diminished chord. And then it resolves into D major. Another added note. So this is slightly different. So we still have from Layer's theme. And it's just, it's now sort of going down. Really remarkable. It's he must have spent hours and hours sort of thinking of those things. It's just not something that you can come up with in a few hours. No matter what somebody tells you, of course you can copy all the theory and stuff, but it doesn't work out that way. There are always things which you can't really do just by theory alone. You have to sort of feel it, man, basically. That's the remarkable thing about Williams, is that it just seems to come very naturally to him. But I think he works incredibly hard at his themes and doesn't really get satisfied until he's settled on something that he thinks is memorable enough. There is a lot of internal repetition in his themes. That is definitely something that happens a lot. And there's a definite design to the shape. So in Princess Leia's one, we've got a widening interval. That's the same as ET. In Han and Leia's theme, we've got a planing idea. Outline. And then it repeats. Climbs up. So it's that second part. And it's all sort of pretty much, there are very few leaps. So apart from the initial leap, there's just one small leap here. Then it's all scale movement and then another leap of that third. Notice that is an inversion, retrograde of the... And then at the end, it's very, very clever, actually, when you really go into it in a huge way. You know, there's sort of the design of it is very carefully thought through. And it's worth sort of copying the same model and seeing whether that's something that can sort of help in terms of, good melody writing generally tends to be sort of structured in a interesting way, and I'm talking about self-contained themes rather than little sort of leitmotifs or things like that, or more extended themes, which are rather different. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. We'll probably go back into Phantom from the next time I see you, but hope you have a good rest of the week. Bye.